Hello Multiverse, welcome to Omniverse Gamers, my name is Damien Bazzio. This video is going to dissect another dynamic encounter. We're going to call this one Tojanita River Valley. This is from Pirates of the Ashen Sea. The party has been making contact with these Tabaxi, as you may have seen from Tabaxi Teens and Wild Boar, and most recently Owlbear Roost Ambush. After that Roost Ambush, where they had stealthily taken out a bunch of owlbears that were sleeping, and doing a really really harsh blow to these owlbears, because that was like their forward base where they attacked the Tabaxi from. So destroying that roost pretty much gave them kind of like, they proved that to the Tabaxi that they were on their side, and they really helped the Tabaxi out, because now the owlbears have to travel all the way from the south to come to the north to attack the Tabaxi rather than coming to this little stage point and being able to just take them. Because they've been taking the youth, they've been taking their little, like, they've been taking their weak and their kids, and they just pretty much grab people out of the sky, off the ground, and bring them into the sky. They don't know where they've been bringing them, they just know the owlbears come and take people. Just like when they were with the armadillo people, if you saw some of the armadillo battles with the owlbears just try to grab them away, kind of like the game Defender. They grab them and they move them away. They don't really know what they do with them, they figure they're eating them, so in today's encounter, they finally get to meet Tabaxi elders. So as they're talking to them, they're like, you know, they realize there's a lot of Tabaxi on this island. Actually, there's a lot. They live in these caves. They're kind of in hiding. They know how to go through the trees and rocks really slowly so that the owls can't see them from the sky, because the owls have really good sight, you know, when they kind of hover way up in this, like, 1,000 feet from the sky, looking down, scanning the ground all the time for victims. So the Tabaxi people have had to learn how to avoid that, basically. So as they're talking to the elders, they kind of, you know, what can we do to help? They're trying to get the Tabaxi and the armadillos and the chameleons that are supposedly on this island too, all together to make an alliance against the owlbears, because the owlbears are preventing them from getting to the temple in the center of the island. That's what the group's trying to do. The captain wants to get to the temple in the center of the island, and there's these five tribes around it. They need permission from one of the five tribes to get to the temple, but the owlbears have taken over the temple, the area around the temple, so they can't get it there. They're trying to make an alliance, and they're building up to this big epic fight where the three, all the races that they can get to join them, are going to attack this temple together and take it back over so they can do the mission they have to do there. But in talking with the Tabaxi, they're like, well, we know the armadillos are almost dead. You guys say that the armadillos are almost dead, because the armadillos are down to like 40 warriors, basically 40, 50 warriors they have in their tribe. They've been being decimated by these owls for a while now. The Tabaxi, you have a little bit more, because they're a little better at hiding. You know, whereas the armadillos live out in the open in the desert, they don't have the hiding skills that the Tabaxi do in this forest. So the Tabaxi are like, well, we know the owlbears have this unfair advantage, because they don't know how the owls basically took over the bear. The owls destroyed the bears, and now they can transform into bears. They don't know how or how that works, the shapeshifting and stuff like that, but they just know what happened. So in talking with the elders, one of their scouts had broken into owl territory, and they found that there was this water source that they have that's coming from another plane. They have this, somehow they're getting this special magical water from the plane of water. Some kind of creature, this massive creature, is pretty much channeling this water into this waterfall for them, and it's going throughout all the owlbears' land, and it helps to make them stronger. They don't know how it makes them stronger, they just know that they're getting some kind of magical benefit. Since this has been happening, the owlbears have pretty much taken over the island. They've been upsetting the balance because they've been just slaughtering everything. So it's not a sustainable situation. And the Tabaxi are just like, you know, we don't have the forces to go into there. Obviously, the party does, because they're a party. Well, we don't want to go in there into owlbear territory and get slaughtered. And they're like, well, we know a way to get there. And you can pop out pretty close to where you need to be, and you only have to travel for a little while through the trees. And we'll send this scout with you. Her name is Tree Floater, and she pretty much takes them to where this encounter is going to happen, where they have this big giant monster is basically the source of the owlbears. Not the source of their magic, but it's a source of power for them that's helping them. So if they can take this thing out and deal with whatever magic is giving the water from the other plane, they can deal the owls a super huge blow and weaken them, which is what they need. There's all these different factors going on, and this island is pretty complex. There's all these factors going on, different factions on either side. But if they can take out this thing, they're going to weaken the whole owl structure, owlbear society. Their whole military structure is going to be weakened, because they won't have the special water. They'll still have a water source, but they won't have this super special water source. And they're going to be it's going to hurt them if they can do this. But this is not going to be easy. This is going into owlbear territory, and they're going to fight a monstrous thing. So the map for this encounter I got from Urza Is Mine, their Patreon's neutral party. Let me show you this map here. As you can see, it's just a big waterfall, and I just liked how the cliffs were way up on the side. So I basically just took this map in Roll20, put it in as big as I could, but I put the border bigger, so it was green, just so they had some forest to travel to, you know. Let me go over to split screen, and I'll show you what the players are seeing. They're up here on this cliff, so on this map. They're way up on the cliff. They're maybe like, you know, I said it was about 100 feet up on this cliff, and this down below, they see this massive, what's called the Tojanita Tojanita. I'm not really sure how to say that. It's an old monster from 3.5 and Pathfinder. It's basically a giant crab meets a giant turtle from the Plane of Water. And I basically just took my King Crab and I boosted him way up. I made him a lot more powerful. I wanted to add more armor class, but also because this thing is colossal, I wanted to, it's like I kind of balanced out. So the armor class ended up being like 18, I think. It wasn't easy, but it wasn't horrible just because of the size, the sheer size versus the armor, because the turtle, you know. But and then the original creature has what's called an ink cloud. It's kind of like an ink cloud to shoot and like poison people, but I changed that into what basically it's a water wave. This whole big, it basically channels the plane of water, and this giant tidal wave just comes rocking out of the sky. It's a way to just push the combat around, push the terrain around, and push the people around that weren't expecting that at all. So as you can see, the party's up here in the corner here, and they can't obviously get down this 100-foot cliff. And they're just kind of deciding what to do. They're kind of like, well, we don't know. Should we kill this thing? What's this thing do? We don't really know the whole story. But they can see that the water is oozing out of this thing. So this thing has a channel to the plane of water. And it is the source of the magical water that's creating this waterfall. There's still water coming out of the rocks, like normal natural water. But this thing is obviously enhancing it. And they're trying to, they're deciding what they want to do and how they're going to, approach and make plans. And as they do that, in the distance they see an owl coming flying, just one. They're kind of wary at first, but they're like, oh my god, what's this, and then they realize that the owl is carrying a little armadillo, a little innocent armadillo, because they've seen them scoop the armadillos up before, and they were pretty successful in stopping them from getting away. So like, oh, what's this, this thing is not going to feed, this thing is going to just feed this thing to this thing, where's it going to, they're kind of all their theories, what this thing was going to do with its armadillo. So the party, they're torn between attacking this owl bear to save this armadillo, maybe, because it's way up in the sky, going to drop them anyway. But if they do that, they're revealing themselves to this monster, and they're going to lose the element of surprise, which they're like, oh, we don't want to get this innocent guy killed, but he's kind of already doomed. Even if they shoot the owlbear out of the sky, there's no way they're going to catch an armadillo falling 500 feet. It's just not going to happen. So they watch in horror as the owlbear just drops the thing. The creature just scoops it right up and just eats it. And they're just like, oh my god, that's horrifying. And they're like, okay, so we got to, obviously this thing's not on our side, and we have to go fight it. They realize it. So the water's rushing. The water's like a really loud waterfall. So it's very loud, very like almost like overwhelmingly loud. So they don't really have to worry about noise. They can, as long as they sneak around and aren't seen, they'd be fine. They can pretty much sneak along the rocks and get themselves into position. They make their plans. The tabaxi that's with them stays up on the top. She's like a scout. She's up there in case anybody else comes to surround them or something from behind or from before or from the sky. She's going to holler to them that more people are coming, basically. So they kind of, they do their best to get up into position. They do actually really well with their stealth checks, and they get right up into position. They get right up on this thing. Like the fighter and the barbarian are right there, like ready to go, as the artificer and the archer and the rogue all have pretty much all ranged weapons. They're down here in the southeast, kind of just chilling. And now these little lines just represent the path that they took. So they just get in position, and then I give them a surprise round. So their surprise round, this thing has a lot of hit points. I don't think I gave it 1,000, but it was a lot. This thing is going to take a lot to kill. And they kind of knew that. It's massive, and it's got, it's got shells, and it's got a pretty good armor class, and it's got the claws. These claws are massive. So they do their, they bam, 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 they all send 5 attacks at it in their surprise round. It obviously wakes up and starts to go at them. The first thing, our fighter has this mariner spear, and when she throws it, she can go with it, kind of. She, like, flies with it. So she throws it right at the thing's face and hits it right in the face, and it sticks into its chin. She's just, like, dangling from it. She's hanging off it. And it's, like, kind of shaking, and they all do their attacks. It turns around. So she's dangling from it with her spear in it. And it, like, grapples her. It grabs her and rips her off its face. And it's got her in its pinchers. And it's crushing her, basically. And she's dealing with everybody else is attacking and fighting. And then, at a certain point, it flings her. It takes her. He throws her 80 feet at the ranger, who's way down here. And she's just flying through the air. The ranger makes a dex save to dodge out of the way. And they kind of land in a, they kind of in a heap. And this thing turns, and now he's turning onto the barbarian, who's right up there with it. And he starts attacking. They all, they're just fighting this desperate fight as it's just swinging at the barbarian, hits it a couple times. The fighter starts running back, shooting her bow as she goes. And then the Tojima ends up getting the barbarian in one of his claws, and now he's got the barbarian, he's squeezing it. And the barbarian's doing his best to, fight against it and not get crushed. As he drags him closer, swings his other claw at the fighter, tries to swing in them, and the range attackers are just range attacking it. It gets right in position. They attack it some more. And then when I get right above them, this is when the tidal wave just rushes right out of him. He just kind of raises his hands up, and out of his, like, just the crevices of his plate and stuff, just water from the plane of water, basically pressurized water from the plane of water, comes rushing down in like a tidal wave, blasting the Ranger, the Rogue, and the Artificer. They make strength saves to try to hold against it, but they don't make them, and they just kind of get blasted backwards. The Ranger is the one that does make a strength save, and he manages to like hold. And I mean, they take damage from the wave hitting them, but they don't get pushed. But the other two get just sloshed right off the cliff, and they're dangling down here. And they're like, oh my god, now they know this thing has this water attack he's not just a close-range fighter. He's got a 120-foot water wave that he can send at them and push them around. And they're just like, oh crap. So they start to, like, spread around. They're trying to, as they're on the cliffs, they're trying to, like, make sure before they attack, I'm securing myself here. And so, like, you know, they want to make sure they're secure. So when this water hits them again, they're okay. And then, you know, they kind of do some more strategic fighting with it. And they get kind of, they're getting into a rhythm where they're fighting this thing one-directional. And, of course, the Tabaxi girl up there, she starts shouting. She's like, behind you. And two of the owlbears, who just happen to be scouting duty, they see this happening. And they come to rush from underneath, from the south. They come to attack, and they come to flyby attacks on the Artificer and on the Rogue, who are trying to brace themselves against the forward attack. Now these things are coming from behind, they have to turn, they have to fight them, and of course the owls turn into owlbears, that's what they do. So now they're fighting this massive toad giant eater, and they're fighting two owlbears, which they've fought them enough, they know the strategy with the owlbears, and that the owls can turn into bears, and how they can fight the owls, kill the owls first before they can turn into owlbear. They have a lot less hit points, and so they know the strategy of fighting them. But now they have two of them and this big guy, and they're just like, oh crap. They went from, you know, oh my god, this big thing, and they, oh no, we got this, and then, oh no, now there's another factor, you know, there's all these things, they always add something else to keep them guessing, you know. So they're fighting, they ended up taking one of the owlbears down, I think before they even turned to an owlbear, and the other one turns into an owlbear. Now, at some time during this, the fighter has two shots with her. She has two of those mariner spears. So the next time she takes another one, she throws it, she follows it, she gets up on his face again. This time she takes a rope and she wraps it around his face. It's kind of dangling there, you can see it's his rope. So she's hoping that if she falls, if the barbarian comes, he can grab the rope and kind of pull at the thing. But they don't really get that attack to manifest, because this thing's just too powerful. It's just gripping them and wrapping them and attacking them. And the owlbears are down there fighting. Now he's got the fighter again in his claws. So they're fighting. You know, the thing gets closer. Now there's an owlbear. You know, they're trying to back away and stay away from it, stay off the cliff. And then eventually the owlbear's down there with them. They go to attack the Ranger. You know, I'm trying to keep the people that are ranged. I'm trying to keep them engaged, which just goes down and it's messing with them. The Tabaxi's kind of hanging off the cliff. The barbarian gets thrown into the water at the thing's feet, and he's fighting from in the water. Of course, as that happens, I'm going to send another wave at him. Just boom, so the barbarian's in the water already. He takes it, but he's a barbarian. He's raging, so his strength, he just like, he takes it and just pretty much stays at the bottom of the riverbed, just taking this water, blasting him. The other ones, they brace a little bit. They take it a little better than last time. The Artificer gets blown back farther away, but actually helps him because he gets blown away from the owlbear, and it helps him kind of fight this thing a little bit better. As the Artificer and the Ranger take care of the owlbear, as the other three just keep going at this thing. Eventually they dealt it, I think it was like 1,200 hit points, I'd like to say. They finally dealt this thing, and then it falls, and it just starts to kind of slide down the water and away. So now that they did this, basically they have taken away the owlbear's magical water source. So now the owlbears are going to be super weakened by this battle. So this battle, as you can see, was just a really fun battle against a monster, like a colossal monster, with a couple owlbears thrown in for tactics, just to kind of keep them guessing, you know, because they're fifth level now. The owlbears they can take on one or two owlbears like nothing. They took on seven last time with four of them at fourth level. So, you know, now they got the idea. That's what I like. I like for them, when they learn strategies, I like to keep them. They can use those strategies over and over to their advantage, so I can just send the same things after them. Like, oh no, we got this. But it's still a factor, so they have to deal with it, you know. So the whole point of this encounter was to weaken the owlbears yet again, because as they weaken the owlbears more and more, they can eventually get to this temple, which is the whole crux of the matter. They have three things they have to do in this game. One of them is get to this temple. So now that they've dealt this blow to these owlbears, it's helping them further their plots on this Astraloxia Island. And as you can see, that's just a combat that was insane, was super, they were just like, oh my god. But they also, they showed where the owlbears were dropping the victims. It showed that the owlbears were getting power from here, and they were able to kill it with effort. And now this thing's dead. Now the owlbears have a problem. Then they actually took all their powers after, and they just kind of took the rocks and they crumbled them. So they completely shut off this spring. So this water source actually will dry up eventually. They dried up this water source, and that's going to really affect the owlbears, and this whole game is going to be affected by this simple encounter. I say simple, but it's pretty much just in this one little, even though it's a big giant map, it literally took place in this little tiny area, and with the water wave, I was able to fight the people far away. So yeah, I hope that encounter was interesting. This was another dynamic encounter. We're going to call this one Tojanita River Valley. Hope that gives you guys some cool ideas, maybe to make something in your own game. As always, just trying to help you guys see how you can use different tactics to make your combats really interesting, and much more fun for your players while still using the exposition and still doing all of your story stuff. We're not just fighting this combat just to fight it. There's reasons for everything happening here. There's a reason. So we are Omniverse Gamers. Like, subscribe, all that jazz. We hope to see you soon, and keep on gaming.